Hey, Parkcrest, Jared here. So excited that we are getting to ready to go to week two in Undivided. You know, it's a great series. Got a chance to kick it off last week, and so we have a great teacher. I'll let you know who it is later on in the set. But hey, wherever you're watching, here's the first thing you need to do. Go to the comment section on YouTube and let us know where you're watching from. Are you, what city you're watching from? Are you watching in your living room? Who's watching with you? How many folks? We really want to kind of get an understanding of, hey, this is the number of folks who are really engaging. And so it'll be really cool if you guys could just let us know that. We also, if you have a prayer request or anything, we have our Parkcrest Christian is also in the comments as well too. Let us know so that we can pray and connect with you. And so, hey, can't wait for this worship to start. Let's get our mind right, get our heart right, and let's enter into what God is calling us to do today.
Savior, In your hands, this is my confidence. So this morning, in the middle of our circumstances, in the middle of questioning and doubting, in the middle of maybe some fearful moments, we come to you, Jesus, and we declare your faithfulness. And that is a unique gift that we can bring you on this earth, that we can say that we trust you today, although it all doesn't make sense necessarily, although we don't have all the answers, but we, your people, can say this morning that you are faithful, that you are good, that you have come through time and time again, and that we're believing today that you're going to come through today once again. So we have hope for yesterday, for today, and for tomorrow because of who you are, Jesus. You have overcome and you have brought new life. And so we come to you as a community from our living rooms, from our kitchens, from our bedrooms, from wherever we are, and we declare that you are good. And we pray this in your powerful name, Jesus. And everywhere, everyone's saying amen.
I love, love, love that song. Thank you again, worship team, just for leading us in this amazing moment where we can focus specifically on God and who God is. You know, if you're here for the first time, hey, thanks so much for coming. We are glad. Let me just tell you a little bit about ourselves. We are a church. We exist to bring hope through connection with Jesus and each other. And one of our values is that we are a church that wants to be sacrificially generous. What does that mean? Is that we're going to give to ensure that other individuals have what they need. And we've been able to do that through over the past 12 weeks throughout the COVID crisis. We've actually ratcheted up. We've ramped up our food security ministries. We've partnered with the city. We've done some really great things. And even just the other week, we held another food bank that is fighting for the food security of people here at Long Beach. And guess why that is able to happen? It's because the people of our church are sacrificially generous. You are generous. And so I want to thank you, every single person who has decided to give. Thank you so much for doing that. It allows us to be the light in a very difficult and hard time. Those who have switched to online giving, which has been a great number of you guys over the past 12 weeks, thank you so much for doing that as well. If you are feeling led to give, you can simply give by texting the amount that you want to give to this number, to 562-203-3363. And we would welcome if that's something you want to do. It allows us to have full ministry here at Parkcrest Christian Church. You know, earlier this week, on Wednesday, as a matter of fact, we had a chance to celebrate our high school students who graduated by having a drive-in graduation experience. Yeah. You know, our longtime student pastor, Scott Slaughter, he gave a great commencement speech. Adrian and Rihanna, the teams in the family ministry as well, caused a great experience. We had two of our small group leaders who were there as well to kind of hand out the gifts that we gave to them. And it was amazing to be able to honor the work that they'd done for 4 years. You know, I remember, like, as I was giving the blessing that it was 20 years ago this year that I graduated. It was Y2K, if you guys remember all the craziness that was going on there. It was Y2K was the year that I graduated. And so everybody who graduated, thank you so much for the work that you've done. Let's thank the parents. Let's thank the small group leaders who've made the investments to make that so that they can make that transition. We firmly believe that the best is yet to come for all of our students and that we're going to walk with them. We're going to pray for them, stay committed to praying for them and supporting them any way that we can. Thank you so much, Family Ministries teams, for an amazing event that you guys did this past Wednesday. Now today we are launching week two of Undivided, and we have our great friend Eric Marsh. He's one of our associate pastors here. He really helps us build our relationships with our city, and actually he helped us partner with Stacy Mungo. He helps us get connected to other churches that are in need, and so a lot of our generosity, it impacts Parkcrest, but it also impacts all over the city, and Eric is the guy who helps head all of that up. And so, hey, let's welcome Eric with some hand clap emojis or whatever you want to do, but let's say, Eric, thank you so much for delivering week two of this message. You guys, let's welcome Eric.
Thank you, Jared. When I was a young pastor, 25, 26 years old, there was a young man in my youth group who went to Millican High School. He was a great kid. He wanted to know more about Jesus. He wanted to follow Jesus. I learned soon after getting to know him, I learned that his father was a motivational speaker. His dad was one of those guys that would go around the country and talk to people about what it took to lead the good life. The difficult part of this story is that his dad had left his mom. His dad had left this kid in my youth group. His dad was telling people what it was like to live the good life and how they could live the good life, but he had hurt people by leading a divided life. When he was on the stage, he was one person. in his relationship with the people that were closest to him, he was somebody entirely different. We're in the middle of a sermon series called Undivided. Jared kicked off the series last week talking about reconciling our inner and our outer lives. It's easy to get mad at people like the father I just told you a story about. But the truth is, most of us, I'd imagine probably all of us, myself included, struggle with this as well. We play the character for so long that we have this character that we share with other people, but there's something else going on inside, something else that is divided in our private lives. Today we're going to look at a short passage, a passage from Proverbs. Proverbs was a book written, it's in the Old Testament, it's right about in the middle of your Bible. It was written for young people. It was written to help them live a wise life. Wisdom. A mentor once told me that wisdom was the ability to see what life is really like. Not only see what it's like, but to act upon it. Wisdom, the book of Proverbs shows us that the wise life is an undivided life. If you have your Bible, turn to Proverbs 11, verse 3. Scriptures say, "The integrity of the upright guides them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by their duplicity." Our integrity, when we have it, when we're undivided, it guides us. And the passage is clear that the divided life is destroyed by its duplicity. The passage says that the integrity of the upright guides them, but how does integrity guide? The author says that integrity works like a boundary. Here's a way of looking at it. The best parenting advice I ever got, I was a young father. We had Caleb and Noah. They were young, two and probably newborn. And I heard somebody say that parenting is much easier when you set clear boundaries for your children. Be clear what the consequences are, but set clear boundaries that they know when they cross those boundaries and what the consequences are. Give them lots of freedom within the boundaries. Don't restrict them within the boundaries. It's the best parenting advice I ever got. Clear boundaries are helpful. City limits are boundaries. I'm a baseball fan. Foul lines are boundaries. When you're teaching your children to drive, as I am right now, the white lines on the side of the road are helpful boundaries. When you have good boundaries, there is freedom. There's life because you know you can operate within those boundaries. You know where the lines are. There is life. You don't have to be scared. You don't have to be ashamed. You don't have to be guilty. The passage in Proverbs says, "The integrity of the upright guide them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by duplicity." So how do I become someone who is upright with integrity? How do we become people who are not marked by duplicity? How do we become people who have and set up good boundaries? How do we become undivided? I want to share a process that I learned. It's a really, really short three-step process that I learned from an author who's a Yale law professor named Stephen Carter. He's a Christian, and he wrote a book called Integrity that I read 15 or 16 years ago. I'm going to give you the abridged version of his process, but his process helped me figure out how do I think deeply about hard things and set up boundaries that'll provide integrity, and that with those boundaries, I will bring life to me and to those around me. Step one, the first step in this process in creating boundaries, creating a life of integrity, is to listen. The way to create clear boundaries, the way to pursue integrity, begins with listening. What do I mean by that? For those of us who are Christians, for those of us who want to be followers of Jesus, the way we begin by listening is we pay attention to the scriptures. We look to the scriptures when we think of issues of character, when we think of issues of undivided or divided life, we have to start by listening to the scriptures. We look to what the Bible says. Take the issue of money. What does the scripture say about money? The scripture has more than 2,000 passages about generosity, about money, about selfishness, about us giving and not hoarding. Jesus spends more than 15% of his stories talking about wealth. If we're Christians, we want to follow Jesus, we have to begin, step one begins by listening, and that includes listening to scripture. But Carter argues there's a second part of listening that is helpful as well, and that is, as we go through life, it's helpful to listen to those who are around us who are living good lives. So if you think of money, who are the generous people around you? And have you listened to them about the way that they think about money, the way they think about their stuff? It's important when we listen to listen not only to scripture, but to brothers and sisters who are ahead of us in life, who are generous, who don't hold tightly to money. A couple months ago, before quarantine, I had the chance at a party to run into somebody at our church. We got talking about generosity, and he told me the story about how, one, he became a Christian, and two, how the person who led him to the Lord, who then began to disciple him, began to share with him about generosity and his stuff. And it was very, very clear that scripture first marked him as he thought about generosity, this man in our church. But he was also shaped as he listened to someone who was living a life well, as he was listening to somebody who took the scripture seriously and had figured out a theology of wealth and was living that. First step, when we want to pursue the undivided life, when we want to have boundaries that give us integrity, is to listen. The second step is to reflect and to decide. It's not enough just to listen. We have to take the next step. We have to spend time thinking deeply and then make a decision. What do I mean about that? Well, it's not enough to think about an issue as complicated as money and just keep the ideas in our head. We have to not just listen to a message, we have to think deeply about it, and then we have to make a decision. All right, what are we gonna do? So for money, Sarah and I, my wife and I, we made a decision a number of years ago that we were gonna give a certain percentage of our income away, straight up. We were gonna give a certain percentage to the church, we were gonna give a certain percentage to things globally, a certain percentage to things locally, and then a certain percentage to just people who for needs that were out there. What that has done, as we listened, as we reflected, we then decided, we then had freedom. We had that money set aside in a different account. We could just give it away. The same was true for this man that I talked to at this party that I referenced earlier. There was great freedom. He knew that he was being generous. He didn't have to feel guilty every time he went out to dinner with his family. He didn't have to feel guilty as he thought about how much could he give, because he had made a clear decision and set boundaries on what the good life was, what the undivided life was with regards to generosity. So this second step of reflecting and deciding. Let me share another topic, and that's the topic of conflict. I'm not talking about warfare. I'm not even talking about long-standing conflicts that we see geopolitically or even in our country right now. I want to talk about something more subtle, something that all of us struggle with regards to conflict we have online. I have a friend, I've known him for about 25 years. He's a really, really good guy. He cares deeply about people, he's generous, but at his core, he loves to fight. He loves to argue. And over the last 6 months, 9 months, he has listened, he has reflected, and he has made a decision to change the way that he engages online. I posted something a couple weeks ago that was, it wasn't inflammatory, it was just a comment, it was a quote, I don't even remember what it was. But I was stunned when I saw, as we all do on Facebook, I saw the comments going down and I saw conflict heating up, and I saw something that was remarkable. I saw my friend change. Instead of continuing to provoke conflict, he actually backed down and he said, you know what, hey, I respect your position, we're gonna disagree, but I respect your position. He didn't continue to fight. I called him later that day and I told my friend, I won't tell you his name, but I said, I noticed something significantly different about the way that you handled yourself on Facebook. And this is a big guy, he's tough, he loves cars. On the other end of the line, he started to cry. He said, I'm so grateful somebody noticed. He said, I've been trying to change. I don't want to fight all the time. He said, I have changed my mind and I've decided to engage in conflict in a different way. My friend was convicted. He loves to debate. He can stay distant from that, but most people can't, and he realized that. So he reflected and he made a different decision. Point three, step three. After listening, after reflecting and deciding, the step three is to speak. It's to tell someone what you've decided. After you listen, after you reflect and decide, it's important that you tell someone. What have I decided? I think this is a reason why community is so important. If you're part of our Celebrate Recovery, you know how important it is, this step three. I mean, you call it a different step. But by confessing your new decision, whether it be in a home community, in a group, in an accountability group, or in a CR group, we have to speak what we've decided. Two quick observations before I close. Number one, you, me, we can't do this without Jesus. This is really hard work. Please don't hear this as just another thing to add. You can't do it without Jesus. I talked to a friend this morning and he said, I wish that life was just perfect from the beginning, but it can't be. The fact is we need restoration, and because of that we need Jesus. This is hard work. You can't do it without Jesus. The second observation is this, is the result of the undivided life is life. Is life for us, it's life for others. Later in chapter 11 of Proverbs, verse 30, the verse says, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and the one who is wise saves life. Brothers and sisters, it is worth pursuing the undivided life that we might have life ourselves and bring life to others. With that, we're just about to head into a time of communion. And if you would like to join us, I'd encourage you to go ahead and get your elements together right now as we turn to the band. Thank you.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
This is Proverbs 11, verse 3. The integrity of the upright guides them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by their duplicity. That's the verse that Eric talked about this morning. And as we were listening and as I was listening, I found myself standing right in the middle of those two things, the duplicity of life and the faithfulness of life. And I found myself falling short all the time. And what God has laid out before us is a beautiful way, but if we are really vulnerable and honest to ourselves, we find ourselves falling short all the time. And so as we step to the table of communion, Jesus is saying, I provide a new life and I provide a new way. In the middle of you falling short, I'm offering you a path to freedom. And so he's offering us to remember this morning, to be reminded of his goodness, and that he's there with us right when we fall short, that he wraps his arms around us and says, I have new life and I have a new path for you. And so, on the night before he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and he said, this is my body broken for you. So we take of this together, remembering that he was broken for us to provide new life. In that same manner, he took the cup and he said, this is my blood poured out for you. So we get to take this together, remembering that he sacrificed himself so we can have new life. So would you sing right now? Would you respond, worshiping him, saying, thank you for all that you do. Thank you that you're giving us new hope today. So let's sing and pray together.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt. Raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life.
Are you singing, oh praise?
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt.
Eric, thank you so much for that message. It's just a gentle reminder that integrity matters. Integrity matters in this season. And so I want to encourage you this week that we will walk in the integrity of God. Whether you are at your job, whether you are online, talking with individuals on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, wherever it is, let's pray that the integrity, our wholeness, our fullness of our undivided lives can show in a way that it points back to God in a unique and amazing way that people will come to know Christ through the life of your integrity. And so, like we do every week, I would just simply love to leave you with a blessing. Brothers and sisters of Parkcrest Christian Church, may this week, you walk in the fullness of God's integrity. May you know your words, May you say your words with love, wholeness, and fullness. And may you reflect to a world that may be filled with darkness the light of God's love. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's get ready for the family moment that will be coming up in just a few seconds.
Welcome to the News and Notes with your friendly neighborhood news anchor, Norman. And the second week of our Daddy Olympics. Oh, keep going! That we have met our contestants. Let us get into our first competition. It is a classic. It is the Daddy Bedtime Story. Shall we? Let's do this.
Our first reader is the greatness himself, Eric.
Your baby's first words will be Dada. Dada.
A strong intro with the baby echo.
The cow Dada says Dada. The baby cow says moo.
It does say moo. What?
The dad sheep says dada.
Yo, that's crazy.
The dad dog says dada.
Yo, that's crazy. Points for the plot twists.
Next up is the double daughter daddy Tony.
Wait, Dad's smarter, not harder.
Wait, Dad's smarter? You don't mean... Oh! Tomu flips the script while his children flip the pages.
Anything to eat, cried Charlie laughing. Oh, you just wait and see.
Points for training me how to raise my children.
Next up is Dadbo, aka David.
Mouse took a stroll through the dark wood. Fox on
house. Good boys! He's talking so fast!
Where are you going, little brown mouse? Coming at lunch at my underground house.
He's like a cheetah from like with freaking words!
Ruffalo, why didn't you know?
Whoa! Points for the simma story time!
Next up is the caped crusader himself, Oscar.
La telaraña de Carlota?
Mom, I want to read the book we're supposed to read.
Okay, do you have it?
Yeah, it's right here.
You straight up say, get that weak stuff out of here. What you really gonna read, Pops?
Let's read the modeling and analysis of dynamic systems.
I remember when my father first read me that book.
Equals KP times 1 plus 1 over T1S plus TDS.
Where T1 is an interval time and TD is a derivative time. Points for making me remember my childhood.
Last to read is Reed.
Wonder Woman tries to make the world a more peaceful place to live.
I love the book choice.
She forces criminals to follow the rules.
Yeah.
And she uses her golden lasso to get people to tell the truth because she knows how important it is to be honest.
20 gold stars.
Now, are you going to go to bed?
No.
Oh, why?
My heart bleeds. You'll need Godspeed to lead, Reed. But points for realistic parenting. Ah! It appears that after all the scores have been tallied up, we have a complete and utter tie. Tune in next week, folks, for the epic conclusion to the Daddy Olympics. We've now come to the notes portion of our program. And to help give us the notes, we cut to the coolest person in the garage, Totally Tammy.
Well, I'm Totally Tammy.
Yes.
And today, the phrase of the day is be slow to freak.
You're not wrong, but it's not like we're out here smelling slippers. Wait! Tammy! No! That reeks so bad it causes you to lose your hearing!
What?
That reeks so bad it causes you to lose your hearing!
What?
That reek... That's not the phrase of the day!
Eureka! I got it! The phrase of the day is be slow to speak. Which I'm already pretty average at.
Thank you, Tammy. You see, folks, in times of craziness, sometimes we think it's best to speak out, speak loudly, and point fingers. But I want to let you know today that God is calling us to be slow to speak. That means we are ready to listen. That means we are ready to think. And at times, if it calls for it, we speak. But we must be slow to speak. I'm your friendly neighborhood news anchor, Norman, and these are the news and notes. Take care, Parkcrest.